crop protection wise, on with this field, we didn't use any herbicide, but one issue with small grains in Iowa and in humid climates, you can have some disease problems. And since we were really concerned about seed quality, whether we're going to be using it for feed or for cover crop seed or whatever our end use might be, making sure you have a healthy seed, that you don't have fusarium or other fungal diseases in that head. So we did use a fungicide to control leaf or late leaf and head diseases on that wheat plant.
We went with what we'd read in magazines as far as recommended fertilizer rates, which was basically don't fertilize it and you can grow it, it'll be fine. Well, yeah, you can grow it and it'll be okay, but you're not going to get good yield and you're really going to see some major variations in the field. We ended up with major disease issues one year. We got hit real hard with fusarium, which then the fusarium affects the germination of that grain later, so we ended up with really low germ seed from it. And that was because we didn't spray any fungicide, because why would you do anything? Why would you spend any money on this small grain crop? You just throw it out there and it grows. It does grow, but not well. You don't do that with corn, you don't do that with beans, so we shouldn't be doing that if we're going to grow stuff for seed.
As with most crops, small grains suffer from many diseases, from crown rust in oats, to fusarium head blight in wheat, to arrogate in rye. Those are a few of the big ones, but there are many others, and it can take a little research to understand the diseases that can affect your crop. University of Minnesota Extension has a good page that compiles many of the resources available in the Midwest about small grains diseases. The first line of defense against most diseases is crop rotation and variety selection. With some diseases, such as fusarium head blight, corn is an alternate host, so avoiding planting small grains into cornfields is one way to reduce disease risk. In addition, choosing resistant varieties can help reduce yield and test weight loss when disease pathogens are present. For conventional farmers, timely application of the correct fungicide is another way to control or lessen the impact of a disease. But how do you know if it will pay? Southeast Iowa farmer Tim Searin, along with other PFI members, have conducted on-farm research to find out.
This last summer we did a fungicide and growth regulator test for practical farmers, and it was a bad year to do a fungicide trial this year because it was a good year for small grains. We had a warm, dry June, and it just wasn't conducive to grow into the inoculum to start the fungus growing in the different diseases. So last year was just the opposite. There was a lot of head scab and fusarium in the rye and wheat. I do some custom wheat for harvest for some guys, it's similar to the rye and disease-wise, and it's a small grain grass crop, and it was all healthy this year, and that helped with the standability and the yield on all of it. So a lot depends on Mother Nature. She's got the upper hand on us no matter what we're trying to grow.
We're scouting for those diseases to see if they're present or see if we're reaching threshold and see what our environmental indicators are that might increase the prevalence of that disease if it is present in the field already, and then that allows us to make a good decision of whether we need to use those products or not.
We'll spray fungicide and usually early June, right about flowering. We want to spray a fungicide at flowering so that we can control that fusarium. And it has to be when the plant is actively flowering. So the rye that I've got now is a much more uniform variety of rye as opposed to just doing a VNS. So that helps with the fungicide application timing.
We're fortunate in Iowa that we have a number of states around us that have really good information on wheat and other small grain production still. Unfortunately, some of the information in Iowa has kind of fallen behind. I know that's being worked on, but we've got some other states we can rely on for that information. South Dakota State, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Illinois, Nebraska, all have some really good information for us as far as small grains production, particularly on the disease side. North Dakota does as well. There's a number of disease tracking programs where they track the development of different fungal diseases throughout wheat and small grains production areas. And so being able to look at those is valuable.
So what agronomists and breeders in the Midwest have been able to do is to calculate when growers are going to start seeing scab, fusarium, on their plants based on determining relative humidity and growing degree days.
As Nathan and David have said, fusarium head blight, also known as scab, the fungal disease that creates vomitoxin in grains, is a common problem in wheat and to a lesser extent rye, triticale, and barley, especially during wet years. For conventional growers, and in years where disease pressure is likely to be heavy, the Fusarium Head Blight Monitoring Network website can be very useful in determining when and whether it's necessary to spray in a given year. If you do decide to spray, timing is essential.
If you look at a fungicide label, it'll tell you at what stage of the plant to apply the fungicide to get the maximum benefit from it. So it's important to kind of understand your different stages of the plant and get it on at the right time, because if you're gonna spray it on and it's too early or too late, well, it's not gonna do you maximum benefit. So, but that's something that I've done more research on and studied more, and that's just part of, if you're gonna grow, it's no different than growing corn. You gotta know your V stages of at the corn, you know, to put the different chemicals on, and that stuff is all on the herbicide labels, and that's why they got the labels to tell you when the proper time to apply it is to get the maximum benefit. So
when it comes to fungicide, there are lots of different products, and each one of those products works differently to control disease. As Tim says, timing is crucial. So whether you're combating crown rust in oats or head scab in wheat, the most important thing is to read the label. In most cases, however, you'll need to understand a little about how staging is different in small grains than it is for corn and soybeans. For a little more detailed explanation, we'll turn to Iowa State University graduate student David Weisberger.
So just like corn and beans, there's a phenological scale that I use to understand the growth and development of small grain crops. And the one that I use is called the Zadock scale, right? And let's say we're talking about a calendar year here. And for a small grain, if things are good, let's call this March. And let's say harvest time is happening sometime in July, right? So growth is gonna happen sometime like this, all right? And I'm just gonna put Z for Zadocks there. And we're going to start at 1, and we're going to go through 10, okay? So starting at 1, what we have really early on is just leaf development, all right? So you might have 1 or 2 or 3 leaves that are coming up. The seed's imbibing water. It's germinating, and then it's putting up, let's say, 1 or 2 or 3 leaves, all right? And we move on from there. After leaf development, you're taking sunshine, you're turning into photosynthate, and you start to reproduce, all right? And what we have next is Z2 at this stage. And that's when we have the emergence of different tillers, all right? So really early on at this stage, what you're determining, right, with these tillers is how many seed heads you're gonna have. And the amount of seed heads is gonna determine your yield ceiling. All right? So as we move on to Z3, what we have here is what's called stem elongation. All right? At that point, what's happening is that the plants have put on different nodes and they're starting to stretch out and get bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay? At some point at the end of elongation is when a really important leaf, the flag leaf, emerges. I'm sorry, I'm a terrible artist. You guys are going to have to put up with this one. All right? This is a really important leaf as it contributes significantly to photosynthesis, right? How much photosynthate, how much carbon the plant can put into it, which is directly related to yield. All right? When that flag leaf emerges, if you're managing in a conventional system where you want to use fungicide, that's one early intervention point where you need to get good coverage. All right? So the major disease for a crop like oats, for instance, is oat crown or oat stem rust. And this would be that first intervention point for something like that. All right? Z4. This is called the boot stage. All right? So the plants are a little bit bigger. They've got a collar, right? You've got a seed head, which is coming up through the stem, right? And it's kind of pushing out that leaf sheath. All right? That's what we call in boot. All right? Z5. So we've got this plant now, and the seed head is working its way up, and it's actually just starting to come out of the leaf sheath collar. All right? This is heading. Okay? Z6. We're going to keep going, right? We've got this bigger plant, even bigger now, right? It's fully headed out. All right? And we've got all these reproductive structures on this seed head. And in oats, that seed head is called the panicle. All right? This Z6 is flowering. And some of you guys from rye production may know this also as anthesis. All right? This is a really vulnerable stage for plant development. The plants have these anthers that extrude or come out, right, so that they can pollinate, right? If this Z6 stage is in a really hot and dry time of the year, you can sterilize these anthers. And when you do that, you end up knocking back your potential yield, right? You're taking away the potential of seeds. All right? And I'll come back to this in just a little bit. All right? If things are good, you keep going through development stages, right? And Z7 is known as the milk stage. So if you squeeze the kernel, you get this kind of pasty, milky substance on your hands, right? So that grain is starting to fill, and at this stage, it's starting to lose water and become just starch, and so become that final kernel, right? Z8, we keep going, right? Plant's about the same height here. All we're doing is we're losing moisture in that kernel, all right? So the kernel is becoming a higher density, starchier unit, all right? And if you were to squeeze one of those kernels now, you'd see that it's pastier. It's less like milk, and it's more like soft dough, which is what this stage is called, all right? And then once we get to Z9, between Z9 and Z10, right, again, the plant's at the same height. All it's doing is that kernel is drying down. The leaves of the plant are starting to senesce or die and dry down. They're moving those last nutrients from the leaves into that seed head. All right, and that kernel, when you press on it now, you shouldn't really, if it's mature, be able to dent that oat kernel much more than just a little bit with your thumbnail. All right, so once we, again, when we get between Z9 and Z10, that's when the grain is really ready to go and physiologically mature. So what that means from a plant perspective is that right under the seed head here, so you can see from my crude illustration, this area right here, right where the stem begins, that area under the seed head or the panicle is called the peduncle, right? And when that grain and when the plant is physiologically mature, that area right there ceases to be green and it'll turn a kind of creamy color, right? So when the seed is physiologically mature, this could be tan. The rest of the plant down here could still be green, all right? So at this point, you have a management decision to make, right? If that's mature and the weather looks good over the next extended forecast or the next week, this would be a good time to swath the grain or cut it from the ground up and let it dry in a windrow, right? If you don't have a swather and you just have the ability to direct cut with a combine, you'd have to wait for management purposes, obviously, till this dries down so you're not bringing a lot of green or greasy material through your combine. So this gives a kind of decent idea using the Zadox gauge. Remember Zadox 1 through 10, leaf all the way through ripe kernel, of how a small grain develops over time, over the course of a season. In this case, I've done an example with oats. I want to come back to this Z6 anthesis for just one more second here. All right? So we've got this panicle that's emerged, and we've got the anthers that are extruded. They're coming out of those floral structures on the grain seed head there, right? The earlier that this can happen in the season, the less likely you're going to have some sort of heat stress related damage. So how we can do that is, number one, cross our fingers and hope for a cool season, right? But from a management standpoint, what we want to do is we want to plant as far back here as we can. That way we can go through these developmental stages and get to anthesis before, you know, July, let's say, when things are a lot hotter and you've got a greater likelihood of a stress day in our climate here in Iowa. So I hope that this was helpful to you guys and that it gives you an idea of how to think of the development and growth of this crop just as you would your corn and soybeans.
In addition to understanding how disease affects crop development, understanding those growth stages is important for understanding fertility and when fertilizer application might make sense for small grains.
We're getting better at it, but there's not a lot of data out there that's available to know what I should fertilize rye at. There's good numbers for oats, and those numbers are changing. And there's some good resources for oats, but for things like rye, there's not a lot of resources as far as fertilizer goes still. NDSU has some decent numbers, but that's for their soil types, and I don't know how, if their recommendations will transfer down here perfectly. But that's what we're using right now for our fertilizer rates.
Well, I've kind of done limited fertilizer. I've tried some nitrogen on it in the spring. I've had good luck getting a lot of biomass and got a lot of growth. As far as yield, I've had mixed results with nitrogen and yield. Now this last year, I took a little different approach. We did some leaf test, sent in some leaf tissue samples just to kind of see what we were lacking. And one of the things I found by doing that is that we were short in boron and sulfur, some of the micronutrients. So I kind of focused more on putting that in the fertilizer. I put 30 pounds of nitrogen on, but we added boron and sulfur to it. And I had good results this year. I don't know if it was because it was just a good year for the rye. I'm going to plan on doing it next year again just to see if it follows through another year. But where we did it, we did a side-by-side yield check, and it made 10 bushel to the acre difference on most of it. Some of it was up 15 to 20 bushel, just depending on the soil type you were on. But I had good results doing that. And that's the best response I've gotten out of any fertilizer on rye.
With rye, I'd like to get dry fertilizer put on before the crop. It's a challenge. Since we're not doing the fertilizing ourselves, we're hiring a local company to do it. We have to work on their schedule. So we'd put dry fertilizer down, then I'll drill. And then early spring, way early spring, like just after frost thaws out, we'll go in and put on AMS, a decent amount of AMS for nitrogen fertilizer and sulfur.
So whether you're talking about a winter grain or you're talking about a spring grain, right? N, P, and K are obviously essential nutrients, and they're going to determine yield potential, and they're going to do it fairly early on. So again, whether you're managing an organic or a conventional system, you need to have, make sure to have an adequate supply of N, P, and K for these cereals, right? And it's not quite what we're talking about with corn and beans, all right? So instead of, let's say, a pound removal, which is what's commonly recommended for corn, if we want to go by that metric, with oats, for instance, or wheat, we're talking more like 3/4 of a pound or 8/10 of a pound, all right? And if you're managing in a system where you can use synthetic nitrogen, this period here, this Z3, when you're tillering and jointing in between this stage, when you add supplemental nitrogen at this point, you greatly enhance the plant's ability to put on additional tillers, which does potentially increase your yield ceiling by increasing the number of possible seed heads you can have in a given surface area. One thing that I would be wary of recommending is that over N additions can be just as detrimental sometimes as not having enough N. So we have, especially in a crop like oats that's a little taller, or rye or triticale, these crops that are taller and that haven't been bred necessarily for high N conditions, when you add too much N, you can have an issue like lodging, which is you end up promoting a ton of growth and you get these very lush stems and you get these heavy seed heads. And then what you have is, on a windy day, or you know, on a heavy rain, or if soil conditions are right, the plants can fall over, which makes management a real hassle and can greatly reduce your yield potential.
By now, let's hope you have a healthy crop that will soon be ready to be harvested. But when do you harvest small grains, and how? Should you swath and windrow, or take them directly with the combine? Next week, we'll hear about harvest from PFI members around the state.